my YouTube channel. My name is Rebecca. If you enjoy this video, please like, comment, subscribe, and ring the bell notification for future updates. In today's video, I'm going to show you how to make a fantasy hooded cape just like this one. It's a really long, flowy cape. And in the back, it has this really nice fantasy hood. I made this cape out of two curtain panels. And I'll show you how to make one of your own out of curtain panels. If you don't have curtain panels, you can use, if you're lucky enough to find two tablecloths that match, you can use a twin sheet, you can use any big piece of fabric. Once you found your desired fabric, the first thing you're going to want to do, if you got it from a thrift store, is wash your fabric. If you got it from the fabric store, you might also want to wash it first. And if you're worried about the cut edges fraying, give it a serge or a zigzag along the cut edge, or even pink the edge, and that will keep it from coming out into a ball of random threads all twisted up. You're also going to want to take your fabric and you're going to want to look at it. Sometimes curtains especially will have sun damage on them or weird spots or something that you might need to work around. So you'll want to check your fabric and make sure that it will work for this purpose. Then what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to find the end with the rod pocket. And on this one it's this end. This is important because we're going to use this as part of the design later. You'll also want to take out any big white tags under the penalty of law. You're going to want to unfold one panel. And on this one, I could use it this way or the other way. But as you can see here, there's a little bit of sun damage, so I think I will just stick with this side as my front. And what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to, on yourself or on a dress form if you have one, is decide how long you want the cape to be from your shoulder to the floor. And what I will do, usually when I do this process, is I will fold the excess over the back. And this might be easier if you have a friend helping you, if you don't have a dress form. And then I'll just wrap that around myself and look at the floor and see if that's where I want the hem to fall. I usually like mine to drag just a hair. I can always pick it up when I walk. You don't want it to sweep the floor like a long train, but a lot of my costumes are long, so. And you'll want that fold to fall right here on your shoulder. This panel, you can make a cape with one panel, but as you can see when you wrap it around yourself and go to tie, there's a lot missing right here in the front and it will look incomplete and like a cheap cape. So you'll want to use two panels if you can find two that match. A lot of times they're sold in pairs. So once we have that, we will neaten up that fold and we're going to mark it. So we have a straight line. As you can see, that's how much I'm going to cut off. And you're going to want to mark and cut that for both panels. As you can see here, I have my piece folded out onto my cutting table. So an easy way to get your fold to be even is to pull the edges up like this and then give it a good shake, and that will help even out your fold. You can take a ruler and measure from the top to the bottom if you need a really accurate cut. It'll be all right if it's slightly crooked. I'm just lining up the edges on the bottom and making sure it's straight. If it's just a hair off, it'll be all right because of the way we're going to do the neck. But once we have that in place, we're going to find some pins. And we're going to pin. We're going to pin along the top right here because this is where we're going to cut. But I don't want to lose my mark. And then we're going to take our second panel, and I'm going to line up that rod pocket edge with this edge, and that will ensure that I'm getting both panels to be even. So once I have that measurement, I'm going to mark that with a pin. And I'm going to do the same on this side. And then when I have my two pins marked for the top of my fold, I'm going to pick it up and I'm going to straighten that out. And sometimes curtains are not even, they're not the same length from top to bottom, so we don't want to make our cape and realize that that happened. So what I'll do is I will take the long side and I will hold it up and I will just go along that fold and make sure that indeed my hem is going to be even. And as you can see, I have a little problem right here because they are not. So I'm going to need to remark that one. This is not something you want to figure out at the end because you'll have to rehem everything and it's going to cause you a lot more work. So once we're sure we have our final measurement where we want it, we're going to cut along this line. And I would like to take a small moment here and talk about the different types of curtain fabrics. A lot of curtain fabrics are really pretty, really shiny, really ornate, because that's how they get you to buy the curtains. However, they will ravel like crazy. So before you just take a pair of scissors to this, you're going to want to keep that in mind, that it's going to ravel on you. So I recommend cutting it with a pair of pinking shears. I'm going to immediately serge this edge, so I'm going to use regular scissors on it. But if you don't have a serger, use pinking shears. Trust me, it will save you a lot of headaches. And we're just going to go take our pin out because we can't cut through pins. And we're just going to cut along our fold. And like I said, it doesn't have to be right on precise, but you want it as close as you can get it. I think I need to sharpen my scissors. So then we're going to want to fold this up and set it aside. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to serge all the raw edges on this one, or just this one raw edge on both the panels. And then I'm going to pin them together with my right sides together. And I'm going to follow this already existing seam. After I serge it. You don't want to watch me sew for 4 hours. So I will pin this together and I will follow right along next to the seam, and then we're going to press that open. And it'll give us a nice Hong Kong type finish on the inside of our seam. If you have a lining, this might be a little trickier. And if you had to cut like a sheet or something, you might have to do some interesting things to press the fabric or your selvages or something together, but that's what we're going to do next. Once we have the curtain side seam sewn together up the center back, we're going to want to press that open. And as you can see on mine, I'm just a tiny bit off, and that's going to be okay because it's going to be hidden underneath the casing. You're going to want to start sewing from the bottom up because we want this bottom edge to be even. If the side hems where they aren't exactly even, that's okay because a lot of times they're not going to be the same on each curtain panel. So don't drive yourself nuts over that. If you do have an excessively long amount, put that side down towards the feed dogs. And if it's less than an inch, you can ease that in as you sew it because your feed dogs are going to move the bottom layer of fabric a little bit faster. And over this long distance of a seam, it's pretty easy to ease in an inch. And now we get the task of ironing this flat. You're going to want to use enough heat to get a good steam and a good press, but don't set your iron hotter than the fabric will allow, because some of these decorative curtain fabrics have a really low temperature and you can actually melt the temperature. If it starts sticking to your iron is too hot. And then to get a really nice crease, I'm going to put my clopper down on it. And that's going to give me a really flat fold. Down here where it's bulky, you might have to go over it a couple times. And this wide hem on the bottom of your curtain might not iron out flat. That's okay. These curtains don't have the best attention to detail. The tag on this one said it came from Target. I don't know if they still sell this one or not because I got it from the thrift store, but if you like the fabric, you could give a good look there. But I'm going to iron all the way back up the rest of this length, and I'm going to press it open with my clapper. If you want, you can top stitch these two down, but because this is a finished hem, it's not going to ravel or do anything weird, and it's going to look really pretty. If anyone sees it from the underside, they're going to assume it's a Hong Kong finish. So once we get that pressed, the next step we're going to move on to is making the hood. And as you can see, I've serged this edge because I don't want that raveling. And if you don't have a serger, you can overcast the edge or you can pink the edges. The only problem with that is you might get little threads of fabric on your actual costume, and that's really never a good look, but you have to do what you can do with what you have. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this other wide rod pocket edge, and for some reason these curtains had a wide pocket on both the top and the bottom. And this is kind of an unusual process here. This wide edge is going to be the front of our hood. And what we're going to do is we're going to cut out the shape of sort of a football helmet. And you're going to want to decide how wide you want your hood to be and how deep you want it to be. And the depth is going to come from one side to the other. This is going to be our center back. So we're going to decide how big we want it. I think I want mine to go right about here. And I'm actually going to cut this so I don't get any weird puckers or anything in my fabric. And that's the general shape we want to draw. I'm not going to use this side hem as my bottom casing because that's just going to add way too much bulk. I have another method for adding the casing, so don't worry about that. If you wanted to try and do something with that, you're more than welcome to try. If you didn't want such a big baggy hood, you would just make it a little bit smaller. If you wanted a long pointy hood, like a wizard cape, you might need to stitch both of these panels that you cut off together, and then you would just make a kind of a triangle that comes down in the back, kind of like a Santa hat. That's how you would get the wizard pointy cape, but I don't want to do that with this one, but that's how you would do that. So I'm going to take my very sharp rotary cutter. You can cut with scissors, but I find a rotary cutter gives you a neater cut. You want to make sure you're only cutting on one layer. Make sure this is a nice curve and you don't have any jaggies. And if you want to use a ruler here, you can. I might do that. And then you can set that aside. You can use it for another project or whatever. If you wanted to, out of the other part that you cut off at the top of the curtain, you can make a handbag or something. I'm also going to cut this bottom edge off. Because as you can see right here, I'm not going to be able to get a string through there. And the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to serge all of those edges. And then I'm going to sew this seam up the back. Once you have your giant hood shape sewn, it's going to look something like this, like a really big helmet of some sort. You're going to want to press open your inside seam. And I tried to stitch just inside my serging line. This is really slippery fabric. If your seam gets a little wonky, don't worry about it. It's inside the hood. No one's probably ever going to see it. You can restitch it if you want to, but this is just a costume. If you're having trouble pressing around this curve, you might want to clip tiny little clips along the curve line to help it lay flat. I pressed it using the curve on my tailor's ham. You can buy these at most fabric stores. I happened to make this one years ago. If you want to see a tutorial or something on how I made that, put a comment down below. But you pretty much just lay it on top of your ham and then you can press right around the curves really easy. You can also top stitch this down if you want. And I'm just slightly off right here. Even though I had my fabric lined up evenly, this is really slick fabric. And what I'll do is I'll probably just hand stitch that under so it's even. So if you have that, don't worry about trying to rip the seam out and sewing it again. If it's not a big amount, you can just tuck it under and stitch it down. So once you have your hood complete, the next step is to find the top edge here of our cape. And I did notice something while I was sewing this together. I have one of my panels upside down because that bottom hem and the top hem on the curtain looked identical. They were the same width. So be careful with that if you have a one-directional print. I don't think anyone's really going to notice on this because it's a really viney type print. And if they do, they're staring at my costume too hard. What we're going to want to do now is you can either hand-based or machine-based, I'm going to do this on my machine, a very long stitch right along here. And I would suggest doing your basting stitches in two rows so when we pull the stitches up we get a more even gather. It's up to you how you want to do it. And you're going to want to use the largest length of a stitch you have. I'm going to stitch mine at a 5.0. It really depends on your machine. But I'm going to put the first one really close to my serging and then the next one just underneath that. And we're going to gather this up to meet the circumference of the hood. So when it's gathered, these two will meet all the way around. So this edge will meet up with this edge. It's going to be a lot of gathers, so just be patient with it, but it's going to give you that really nice full effect. Once you have your two lines of stitching sewn, hopefully evenly together, you can start gathering it. Some of these fabrics are super duper slippery and it makes it hard to get an even row of stitching. You're going to want to find your two bobbin threads and you're going to want to pull on them to gather the fabric. When we're done, we're going to have a really full gather that's going to look something like this. But I'm going to finish scrunching all this up and then I will show you the next step. Once you have your cape all gathered, it should look something like this. This might be a little too fully gathered, but what we're going to want to do is take our right sides and place them together, and we're going to want to place the hood center back seam up against the cape center back seam, and we're going to want to align those as best we can and put a pin in. We're just going to slide the fabric back out a little bit because I have this gathered way too tight. And we're just going to adjust these gathers until it's the same size as the neckline of our cape. You're not going to want to have it gathered really too much right here on this side part where the side of the cape meets the side of the hood, the front part there. So I will finagle this a little bit more and then I will show you the next step. Once I get this pin flat, I'm going to sew the seam up. Once you have your hood stitched onto your cape and you've looked around the edge and made sure that your basting stitch isn't visible, if it is, you can just take a seam ripper and pull the thread out pretty easily. You're also going to want to make sure you don't have any bubbles or puckers or anything weird with like the cape getting caught in the seam. Once this looks the way you want it, we're going to press this open. I know a lot of patterns will have you press the seam up towards the neckline, but in this instance, we're going to press it open. And you'll also, because you're going through so many layers of fabric, I stitched this with a 3.5. It just made it easier for the machine to go through all these puckers of fabric. You can try it on now if you'd like and see how it fits and make any adjustments before we move on to the next step. This should lay fairly flat. We're going to go ahead and give it an iron and some steam. I think my iron shut off. So I'm going to go ahead and press this open once my iron heats back up. And then I'm going to take some bias tape. And we're going to press it open and we're going to stitch it down like so. And this is going to make our casing. It's okay if this sticks off a little bit on either side. If you want, you can press this open even more. Because this is bias tape, it's not going to ravel. I went ahead and pinned my bias facing on over the seam. You're going to want to give yourself a little bit extra so you can fold the end under and have a nice finish right here. And also because this will shift around a little bit when you stitch it. You can, if you want, stitch a line through the top part of the hood when you stitch this part down. When you stitch the bottom part, because there's so much fabric going on under here, you're just going to want to stitch it to the seam allowance right here, not through the bottom of the cape, because that's going to make it wobble and do some really wonky things. So I'm going to go ahead and stitch this, and then I will show you the next step. So once we've stitched our casing down, it's going to look something like this. And if you stitch slightly off the edge in some places, as long as it's not a lot, it's not really going to make that much of a difference. And I have this line of stitching on the other side from the top part of the seam and a fairly uniform amount. If this meanders a little bit and it gets narrower in some places and wider in others, it's not going to make that much of a difference because this is going to be gathered again when we put the drawstring in and the cape is going to be folded back down over it. So don't worry about it if it's not perfect. But for the drawstring, I just took some narrower bias tape and I stitched it. And I have it secured on a safety pin. You could use ribbon, you could use round cord, you could use anything that you want to feed through here. And also, if you want, you could use some braid trim. You could put some braid trim right here. You could hand stitch this down if you wanted to. I would suggest against this because when you pull the drawstring up, this isn't going to let it gather as much. But you could, if you wanted to, if you needed to hide anything, just put some trim around the hood, maybe around the front seam or the front opening. Especially if you're like me and you happen to get a whole bolt for a dollar. That was a pretty good find at the thrift store. Anyway, to feed the string through, we're going to put it on a safety pin and we're going to just push it through. There are plenty of feeding tools. You could get a bodkin or something. You might also want to put another safety pin on this end and pin it to the side so you don't pull it through. can see right here I missed a little bit, but I'm not going to worry about that too much. I can always hand stitch that closed as well. Costume capes don't need to be perfect. If you're just making it for yourself, it can have tiny little flaws that just adds character. And if anyone is staring at your cape hard enough to notice these things, they're being really creepy and you should probably say something to them. And to measure how much of the drawstring I wanted, I just wrapped it around my neck and gave myself plenty of room to tie with. So when you're done, you're going to want to give yourself a giant knot. So the cape is all finished now. I have, you know, the pretty hood, and then it is quite long. This one doesn't quite drag on the ground, I don't think, but it's as long as I wanted it to be. I have my ends here tied together because I didn't want to lose them inside the casing. If you're going to use a round rope like the one that's on this cape, you're going to want to give yourself at least a 1-inch casing. You don't want to get all that stitched and then find out that your method of closure isn't going to work. You can also put like a shawl clip or a, there's actually cape clips that you can put on. They're more like a bar and a hoop. But we're going to put this on. If you've never put a cape on before, this might be a little tricky to get the hang of it. We're going to tie it up tight. One thing you will want to know about capes is they will slide backwards against your neck. That's just going to happen. If you read a commercial pattern, it's going to have a cutout curve shape on the pattern. We did that with the gathering. But if you're having issues with that, you might want to cut the back on a curve and attach it that way. The hood can be a little tricky to get on the first try, but you'll want to have it set just in front of your hairline for that nice fantasy effect, and hopefully get your center seam in the front. It can be a little tricky the first couple times you put one on. But I'm pretty happy with how this turned out, even though I got one of the panels on upside down. I really don't think anyone's going to notice because of the sparse viney pattern on this. I think this cape is going to be a lot of fun to wear. So this is what the back of the hood looks like. It's got that nice poofy bag in the back. I may have made this hood just a little bit bigger, but you can adjust that and that football shape that you made when we cut the hood out. But overall, I think this turned out really, really, really well. It's too dark outside right now to take any pictures outside. It's almost 10 o'clock at night. But if you found this video helpful and you want to make one of these for yourself, it only took me about 2 hours, including the filming time, to make this, because pretty much we're using just the side seams and the bottom seam of the fabric, or the bottom hem. And then we're just putting up a seam in the back and then around the neck. It's just really, really quick to put together. So if you enjoyed this video, please give it a like, a comment, a subscribe, ring the notification bell if you really enjoyed it. And thank you all so much for watching. And I will hopefully see you tomorrow in full costume.